I worked for Hamza for about 3 to 4 months as his thinker, strategizer, his visualizer. So this is a very interesting job, one of the most interesting jobs I've ever done. At some point, the YouTube algorithm decided that I needed to watch Hamza. Every other recommended video was this guy's face wearing a bathrobe on my feed. And I didn't really like his titles or anything, but after seeing him so many times, I had to click on it and I went through the Hamza rabbit hole. I watched a whole bunch of his content, really liked it. I really liked his message. I was really convinced by him. I found that he was genuine, and eventually he makes a community post saying he wants a thinker. So he wants somebody for strategy and to be a visionary and have a vision for his channel, somebody to discuss things with and plan with. I thought this was the perfect job for me. And if you don't mind, I'm going to be preparing my breakfast while I talk to you about how Hamza is in real life outside of YouTube. So I filled up the application for his thinker position. He literally was hiring somebody to think for him. Hear me out, it's not as stupid as you think. So Hamza is a very, very intelligent guy. He is much more intelligent than he seems just by looking at his videos. He has a very strategic mind, and he has a very good understanding of his emotional capability and how to use that and balance it out with logic. So anyhow, so I send in the application out and I try to make the application as good as possible. I talk about my experiences in college, in traveling, the military, and 100 other things which show that I can actually help Hamza strategize. I told him about the books I've read, the things I've written, and my goals and ambitions for the future. And Hamza really liked it. So he sends me an email. Hey, I saw your application and I really liked it. Would you like to do a video call? Just like that. Here was a big YouTube channel. I think he had 500,000 followers at the time, and he was willing to do a video call. What happened is I did this video call with him and he asked me why he thinks his movement is important. So I told him the truth. I told him perhaps the most important mission in the world right now is this crisis of masculinity, to use the cliched phrase, that men simply are not taking responsibility for their actions and not taking responsibility for the consequences. Because of this, there is massive depression, mental illness, all kinds of societal problems that we see today. My case was, of course, there's big problems like climate change, income inequality, 100 other things that you can talk about. But you can only solve those problems if you have a strong society to begin with. So you need a society of well-disciplined, responsible, determined men who can actually fix the problems that we have. So Hamza really liked the logic of that, obviously, because that's his brand, right? And he does absolutely believe in his brand. So I get the job. I'm Hamza's thinker. How it worked is we would do video calls. I'm gonna put this piece of bread in the toaster oven. We do video calls every week or so discussing strategy. So when we first started, this was when we realized that the Jeffrey and Adonis intro, right? It used to be that Hamza kind of viewed Jeffrey as the enemy. Now Jeffrey is a thing which we should not be like, we should kind of hate, and Adonis is the aspirational figure. But we discussed this at length and we realized, well, Jeffrey is not really the enemy at all. Jeffrey is a victim of a broken society. What I mean is the structures of society that exist today have no support for young men growing up and finding their identity, which is of course Hamza's entire message. So Jeffrey is not the enemy. Jeffrey is actually the audience themselves. And in fact, it is Hamza himself when he was younger. So we discussed this, and now instead of doing Adonis good, Jeffrey bad type intros, we would do Adonis helps Jeffrey improve his life, or rather Jeffrey looks at Adonis and improves his life, or something along those lines. Instead of making Jeffrey the enemy, we treat Jeffrey as a friend, and every single Jeffrey is a Adonis in the making. So we had a better understanding of our intro when we had those discussions. Then Andrew Tate decided to blow up.
Someone has to f***ing flip the burgers, dumbass.
This was when Andrew Tate was, he was not in jail or anything, you know, he was doing very well for himself on TikTok and YouTube and everything. He was just blowing up. And Hamza and Andrew Tate kind of share a similar audience of young men who want to improve themselves. So the question was, should Hamza associate with Andrew Tate? See, Andrew Tate is highly controversial compared to Hamza. Hamza is talking about wholesome things like mental health, physical health, spiritual health, and Andrew Tate is just talking about cars and smoking cigars and has very controversial opinions on women and everything. The question for Hamza was, Andrew Tate and him share a similar space. And by the way, guys, you're going to learn how to make a very good bomb omelet. So I'm going to make my omelet with ghee, actually. If you're using oil, stop. At least use butter. And if you want to be really elite level omelet, you got to use ghee. Elite omelet coming up. And of course, if you want to make a good omelet, you got to get the best quality eggs. I get these Happy Egg Company eggs. They're really good. But anyway, where was I? Andrew Tate. So the question becomes a question of strategy, because Andrew Tate was unpredictable. We didn't know what he was going to do next or say next. So if Hamza decides to associate his brand with Andrew Tate's brand, and Andrew Tate does something stupid slash very controversial, that could reflect badly on Hamza's wholesome image. My advice to him was, don't associate with Andrew Tate publicly, because it was just too much risk. We didn't know him personally. We didn't know what he was going to do. And besides, Andrew Tate was very successful before he even became a influencer. Andrew Tate made his money before he came to YouTube or TikTok. That's not the case for Hamza. Hamza's infrastructure depends on YouTube. He wasn't rich before YouTube. So he decided not to deal with Andrew Tate, not to publicly support or talk about Andrew Tate. But in the end, Hamza disagreed with me, and I'm glad he did, because I made it such that it was a question of strategy. You know, what's best for Hamza's image? What's best for Hamza as a brand? It was never for me about Hamza's honesty. And the fact of the matter is, Hamza did like Andrew Tate's content, and I did too. I don't agree with everything Andrew Tate says, but his mindset on success, connections, and networking are really, really good. And Hamza believed the same. So Hamza, according to my advice, did not talk about Andrew Tate at all. But eventually he did break with my advice, which is good. And he talks about how Andrew Tate is the most misunderstood man, and he actually supports Andrew Tate in public now. Big divergence from where he was. I'm glad he was able to do that. We spoke about monetization, of course. We talked about how to make money. So Hamza really doesn't want to be like all the other influencers who just sell shit and make money. I was of the opinion that selling stuff, so long as the thing provides genuine value to your customer, is not a bad thing and wouldn't harm his image. But see, Hamza's right. If he sold low ticket items, he would hurt his image in the long run. And I was incorrect. Hats off to Hamza for having his own thoughts and not just following whatever I said. So in the end, Hamza did not actually sell any low ticket items. He didn't sell any low ticket courses. He sells one extremely high ticket course, which I don't think you guys even know about, but he sells a course on how to have better sex. Literally, Hamza has a sex course, a high ticket sex course, which he sells not publicly, like not on his main channel or anything, but only on his like download channels. If you're on his email list, you might have access to it, and even then, it's not a sure thing. So he has a high ticket course, but doesn't publicize it at all because he doesn't want the negative image. He really, really cares about the genuineness and honesty of his brand. So when I was working with Hamza, I had to actually report for a 2-week stint of training with the army. So I was gone, you know, I was in the army barracks, in the camp training, and I would still be able to find the time to talk to Hamza, do these video calls and discuss strategy, because even though I was really tired and I was doing this army shit, I actually found so much value from Hamza that I decided to sacrifice a little bit of my sleep. Even though I was tired, I would still talk to him, help him if I could. That's how much I respect the guy. I would not do that for anybody else except for Hamza. So I am a fan of him. There's no question about it. He brought a lot of value to me, and I'm really proud of having worked with him. I'm kind of sad that we don't work with each other anymore. So what is Hamza like off camera? You might be surprised to know this, but Hamza is literally the same guy on and off camera. He's actually legit. He's actually the real deal. That's my assessment after working for multiple months with him. No one can make a fake appearance last for 3 months. So I did multiple calls with him, and he is really the guy behind the camera. So what I mean by that is, he genuinely cares about the upliftment of young men in today's generation. So no question in my mind that that's his highest priority. So when we realized that Jeffrey was not the enemy, we tried to find out who the enemy really was. And our conclusion was the enemy was social media and porn. So we decided to go after social media, just talk and expose the way social media apps and channels manipulate our minds. And we were making videos about this consistently for at least 2 weeks, just talking about Instagram. And this was the time in which Hamza got banned off Instagram, actually. And it was really interesting because Hamza makes a video against Instagram, and just 2 days later, he gets banned by Insta. And he didn't do anything. He didn't post anything inappropriate or anything like that. So it seems to be that somebody at Instagram saw this video and saw the power that it could have and decided to ban him on Insta. Till now, we have no idea why he got banned at that time. Eventually, Hamza gets banned on more and more channels. I believe he's banned on Discord now. And before, he was banned on Skillshare. So his Skillshare course was making him about 50% of his income at the time when I was working with him. So when he got banned off of Skillshare, he had to cut some employees off. And that was why I don't work with him anymore. After watching Hamza's latest video, I realized how far he has come in just 2 years. Just 2 years, this man didn't even have a channel. In 2 years, he not only created a successful YouTube channel and a business, he managed a whole team. He started a movement of 1 million+ men who genuinely want to get better at life. He did everything without much controversy. I mean, he had that one beef with Sneeko, but even that's nothing compared to a lot of what these influencers do. So it really goes to show you how a normal man, an intelligent Asian man, mind you, was able to go from almost nothing to so much, having such a massive global impact in just 2 years. So it inspires me. It tells me that I have no idea. I cannot imagine where I will be. That should be what Hamza's story is to you, is a story of inspiration of how much you can accomplish when you focus yourself on one goal, on one purpose, and do it consistently over the long time period. And Hamza, he really proved that you can do it. Everybody was talking about how YouTube is saturated, social media is saturated, but no, the man just went for it. And in 2 years, he built this whole empire of wholesome, good advice for young men. That is such a difficult yet noble pursuit that he has absolutely succeeded in. And watching his latest video, and he talks about how that outer layer of purpose of helping other men has kind of dissolved, and he needs to revisit that. All that concept comes from David Deida's The Way of the Superior Man. That book was very influential on Hamza and a lot of men, including myself. One of the principles from that book is there are layers of purpose. Every single person on this planet has a purpose, but the purpose is not just one thing. You work on a purpose for a given amount of time, and when you reach a certain level of success, it falls off, and then a deeper level of purpose is revealed to you. That is what has happened to Hamza. He has succeeded as much as you can succeed on YouTube. Could he get more followers? Probably yes, but his outer level of purpose has been met, and he has found a deeper calling in martial arts. So I wish Hamza the absolute best of luck, and I hope he really succeeds in finding what he's looking for through martial arts. His journey has inspired me to start my own, and I have no idea where this will lead me. I invite you to be a part of it, and first I gotta make my breakfast. All right, you guys, I was able to make my breakfast, and I'm gonna crack open a new bottle, olive oil, and I would like to conclude by saying what Hamza achieved is not closed to any of us. All of us can take something from what Hamza has done, learn from it, and even improve upon it. Here's what was unique about Hamza and how he was able to blow up. He was brutally honest about his problems, and he was brutally honest about his failures. He was radically open about his worst insecurities. He was talking about how he had gynecomastia. He was talking about how he had man boobs. Like, how many guys have the courage to get on YouTube in front of thousands and thousands of people and say, I have man boobs, I don't know how to fix it, I've always felt insecure about it? How many people have the courage to say that? The fact that he was brutally honest was what made his channel stand out and grow when so many other channels failed to. From Hamza, I learned that brutal honesty, radical transparency, consistency are all you need to live a fulfilled life. Enjoy your breakfast.